Have you heard of exascale computing? And do you know what these supercomputers can do for you? Brandon Drager, he's the head of compute and product marketing at Hewlett Packard Enterprise, is here to talk about all these new exciting developments. Brandon, welcome and great to have you on the show today.
Great, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here today.
And if we talk about exascale computing, not many people have heard about it. Can you explain more about it, what it is, and especially what are we celebrating today?
No, absolutely. So exascale computing is really kind of a new milestone in supercomputing. So when you talk about supercomputers, it's typically these large systems that are highly integrated, that are meant to address, you know, kind of grand scale problems of research, modeling and simulation, basically translating physical phenomena into digital representations of those so they can better be understood and studied. So with the advent of exascale computing, that's really kind of basically a description of the number of calculations that can be performed every second. So here's a new term that I'm sure most of you have not heard of before. It is basically an exascale system can essentially do a quintillion calculations every second. So this is a massive increase in the amount of compute power over current systems, which are typically called petascale systems, and that's a quadrillion calculations. But let's talk about a quintillion. So how big is a quintillion? So that's essentially 10 to the 18th flops. So if you did a scientific notation, so 10 to the 18, that's also why we're celebrating. It's a little hat tip to why we're celebrating on October 18th, 10 to the 18th. It's essentially a billion. So to put that into just a numerical perspective, roughly the Milky Way galaxy is roughly a quintillion kilometers wide. So that's just kind of just give you a little bit of a kind of understanding what that number means. And if we put it into kind of computing terms, you know, something that hopefully most folks could understand is that if you had every person on Earth, so let's say roughly 8 billion people today, doing one math calculation every second for 24 hours a day, it would take them over 4 years to do what one exascale system could do in 1 second. So that's just at one exaflop. So it's just a tremendous new level of compute power that we're bringing to bear to really solve kind of the world's most pressing problems.
That's amazing, really impressive. Can you make it more concrete and share some examples how both people's life and on the other hand, organizations will be impacted by this supercomputing?
No, absolutely. So the new computing power, I mean, really what it allows you to do is a couple things. And this applies to both research institutions and commercial institutions alike. What you're able to do with more compute power is essentially increase the fidelity, so to speak, of what you're modeling and simulating in the real world. So for example, one that's, you know, very pressing and has been increasingly on a lot of people's minds recently is around weather and climate simulation, right? So as we've seen, the last few years has been a really tough one for fires that, you know, kind of really hit Australia very hard. And then also in my home turf here on the west coast of the United States, we've been, you know, pretty ravaged by wildfires. And largely a lot of that is being attributed to, scientists are attributing to a lot of that is the effects of ongoing effects of climate change. So what exascale computing would allow researchers to do, and what they're increasingly doing now, is being able to simulate at a much higher level of resolution of weather environments. So when you think about weather and climate prediction, it's really kind of a multi-physics, multi-kind of geophysical fluid dynamics problems. There's a lot of really complex variables that'll have to be modeled over time together. You have to take into account, you know, vegetation, topographical features, all these really complex features. And today, you know, kind of the best weather modeling is really kind of getting down to, you know, like a kilometer range. Some are less than that. But what we're expecting with exascale computing is that it's literally down to, you know, sub-kilometer level, down, you know, kind of the few tens of square meters level of simulation. So really being able to understand kind of the lasting and ongoing impacts that we can expect from climate change and how we impact and roll those back, right? What are the things that were the meaningful things that we could potentially do to understand that? Also understand, you know, how those kind of changes might short-term impact You know, both, you know, kind of impacts on the economy, so impacts to agriculture, impacts from, you know, potential property damage due to fires and flooding, things like that. So there's a lot of really, you know, kind of capabilities that you're getting from an exascale system. And that's just kind of one, I feel like one really present example I think everybody can kind of understand a little bit.
Yeah, weather forecasting, everybody can imagine because it's very hard to predict very well. And what we see in the past is more computing power means exponential growth in possibilities, in new Absolutely. Applications, new opportunities. Can you share what we can expect in the near and even in the long-term future with exascale class computers, supercomputers, and what they will bring us?
Yeah, no, and what I really love is, you know, I think I've kind of got my own opinions that I'll share, but I think that, you know, Thomas Zachariah, who's the lab director at Oak Ridge National Labs, who expected to probably potentially receive the first U.S. exascale system. So the way he's described it, I think, is really, you know, easy to understand. He's always viewed, you know, supercomputing and even in particular exascale supercomputing is really a time machine that's going to allow us to see into the future. So I think that's just really powerful and really an easy way to kind of think about the capabilities that we're going to be getting from exascale computing. So when I think about, you know, beyond, you know, kind of the weather and climate change example that I shared earlier, it's really going to impact everyone's life on Earth for the next few decades and even beyond. It's really going to touch, you know, everything from the way we manufacture, right? So thinking about new ways of manufacturing that are allow us to be more efficient, use new materials, you know, to be able to, you know, kind of really think about how we're building building the products that we all consume, making them more sustainable. So being able to do things like additive manufacturing, so 3D, you know, printing, so to speak, you know, on large scale, and really being able to create, you know, kind of new structures that we weren't able to before. It also gets into things like material science. So a lot of research is going to be done on renewable energy. So both on the front of, you know, unlimited free power, that is the promise of a fusion, commercialized fusion power, which hopefully will come, you know, in my lifetime, or kids' lifetime, and also in, you know, kind of the material space around being able to create new, more efficient batteries that allow us to take more advantage of renewable energy, you know, more efficient, more effective electric vehicles, that type of thing. But I think the other one that's also very present for a lot of us right now, with the global COVID pandemic that we're all dealing with, is really kind of the promise that exascale computing has for looking at, you know, kind of major medical and health issues. You know, so for example, around COVID research, right, we've already seen a lot of really fantastic advancements happen very quickly in the realm of COVID research. And largely that's been powered by, you know, supercomputing. So today's supercomputers are fantastic. What we're going to expect to see with these exascale systems is they'll be anywhere from 2 to 5 times faster. So just think of the impact of being able to do these simulations where we're trying to understand, you know, how different compounds interact with a virus that can either prevent or treat their effects, and being able to do that on a much faster scale overall. And that just extends to, you know, kind of all aspects of, you know, human physiology. So kind of another really interesting one that I find is, you know, kind of the ability to, you know, at the neuron level, being able to create full level simulations of the human brain to really understand how to treat and reverse brain damage or other degenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's. So it's really exciting and kind of the different effects that it can have across, you know, research. But also too, you know, we're seeing, and I'm really excited, some of the stories that are coming out with exascale day to day from a lot of our commercial community members within the exascale system, and just really on how they're thinking about, you know, applying, you know, kind of exascale technologies to their own workplaces, right? So being able to, again, better serve customers in various ways, better create better products, better experiences. So it really has very broad-reaching impacts, even just outside of the kind of these grand challenge problems that we've talked about. So it's really going to be a present set of technologies that we're going to see, you know, kind of roll out here over the coming years.
Yeah, and I think for everybody, it's really required to keep a close eye on it because these developments are amazing. Thank you, Brandon, for sharing all these new exciting developments that you have. And once again, happy anniversary with the second Exascale Day. and all these new exciting possibilities. Thank you. Yeah,
and thank you, and you, and thanks to all the visionaries and leaders out there who continue to ask, you know, what if, why not, and what's next? They're really the true heroes of today. So we celebrate them as much as we do the technology, if not even more so, because it's really those folks that are powering our future.
Definitely. Thanks a lot. And for the audience, thank you for watching, and we see you next time.